friends and students and teachers and everyone. So thanks again for being here. How is everyone doing this afternoon?
Great.
Good.
Good.
Good. How are you doing, Dr. Bolger? Actually, can you show me your face? How are you doing?
Sure. I'm doing very well.
You can't see his face, but he gave me the big smile. All right, so I want to do a test. I want to see if this music sounds like matches his expression. Expression and emotional engagement. direction to do music. The second is just an interest in emotional psychology in general, and I thought it would serve me as a composer to look into the underlying mechanisms, both physiological and neurological, that accompany emotion perception or emotion expression in you and I. And lastly, it was an interest in computer programming, which I had my wife Julia to think for. When I began thinking this idea, she had started her training to become a software developer. I got really inspired to just learn all the cool things you could do with computer programming. So with that, I want to show you just a big picture of how this project works. So this diagram just shows a really simplified data flow of how the system works. So the first is, at the top we have an input, a facial expression, and at the bottom we have an output of mood congruent music. So in the center we have what's called a black box, and the black box is just a real simplified abstraction of how the system works. But in there is all the algorithms and the design and the whole programming of what makes the system possible. So for those a little more tech-inclined, here's the technology I'm using for the project. The first is called Face OSC. It's, you can see a screenshot of it here. It's what captures the face and outputs activity based on facial landmarks such as your eyebrows, nose, lips, jaw, openness. It outputs all this data as numerical data flow. The next is called Weconator, which you won't really be seeing, but it is what I use to create emotion recognition models. So essentially, I taught the computer how to recognize different emotions from my face using this technology called machine learning. Next is the core of the project called MaxMSP. It's where I've allowed all the different technologies to communicate, and I've made the whole user interface, and the whole design of the system exists in that part. And lastly is called Ableton Live, and that's what I'm using for some of the audio playback in part of the project. So, with that, before I go into layer one, and actually during each section I'm talking about, I'll be explaining different applications that I think would be really neat or useful next steps for the project. But I also have been encouraged by, well, as I've been working on this project, everyone else's ideas and what they might want to use for the system. So just be mindful of ways you might want to use this or think it would be useful. And I'll have a short Q&A at the end just to hear some of the ideas that you guys might have. Okay, so we'll begin layer one. This is called Emotion Jukebox. And as I explained, this part of the project uses your facial expressions to select from one of five compositions that I wrote expressing these emotions. And so, of course, I'm using the face as the input for this project. So why am I using the face as the impulse for this? There's two reasons. The first is that I think it's very culturally relevant to be using the face to drive the system. I think we live in a term we call selfie culture, where people have become increasingly obsessed with their own faces. This project makes no judgments or assumptions on that fact. It's just a small stat is that in 2015, 24 billion selfies were uploaded to the internet, and that's just through Google's platform. So that's likely to be just a small number of how many billions and billions of selfies were uploaded to the internet. Secondly, you may have noticed the rise of face-driven technologies in your mobile devices or apps like Instagram and Snapchat, where not only are they entertaining, but they've actually become increasingly useful to use your face as an input for different services on your phones and whatnot. Next is that our faces are the primary site of emotional expression and identity, and I wanted to use technology to connect human emotional expression to musical expression in fun, new, and interactive ways, and I think I've done that here. And two more things before I show you some more music. This is some important background information. So there's two, like I had said, your face is the primary site of emotional expression, but we need to be able to talk about emotion in useful ways to understand the system. So there's two general models for describing emotion. There's the discrete or categorical model, and that states that there's a basic set of emotions that all other emotions rise out of. And a common list is proposed by the researcher Paul Ekman. It's happiness, sadness, anger, fear, disgust, and surprise. I've used a modified list of happiness, sadness, anger, fear, and serenity, or calmness, just because these emotions are slightly more readily expressed through music, and they're all still considered basic emotions generally. The next is a dimensional model of emotion. And this posits that emotions are felt and can be described on two dimensions, a valence, which is this x-axis right here. And so the valence describes how positive an emotion feels, and arousal describes how active that emotion is. So for example, anger is a low valence, high arousal emotion. It doesn't feel good, and there's a lot of it. Sadness is a low valence, low arousal emotion. It doesn't feel good, and it's more subdued in its expression. Serenity is a high valence emotion, feels good, and it's low arousal, that's not as active. And lastly, happiness, even though it's followed in a weird space here, is a high valence, high arousal emotion. So both these models, the discrete and categorical model, are used throughout this project. So with that, let's pull up. Let's cue up a different song using my bass. Silly. But our face is a combination of several, actually quite a few muscle movements. And the same researcher I had mentioned earlier, named Paul Ekman, has actually created a system called facial actionated coding system that is just a taxonomy of all the muscular movements in your face and their different combinations of what they result in expression-wise. Oh, I don't have too much time to go into detail about that there, but you and I, when I look at your faces and you look at mine, we don't have to go through a whole like system writing down which each muscle is changing. But my computer does. My computer doesn't have the innate ability to understand facial expressions. So what I had done, as I mentioned earlier, I trained the computer using machine learning to recognize different emotional classes. So I gave it a set of classes it can choose from: happiness, sadness, anger, fear, and serenity. And I made correlations between certain data inputs from face OC and these different emotional classes. And the computer was able to learn to make correlations on new unlabeled facial expressions. So I knew that was a little technical, but that's how I did that. great, so with that, let's pull up a different expression using my face.
Thank you.
oscillates in a major mode, and it's generally quite dynamic throughout the song. And some other more detailed information is that the stepwise melodies have been found to convey lower emotion senses, serenity, and calmness. But there's a few other more important things, or just as important things, is the emotional connotations of the use of the sitar. And actually, we have the sitarist in the house, Roger, that played on that track. But there's other types of coding emotion in music. We mentioned referential and intermusical, but associative coding works like this. For many people, the sitar has connotations of ideas like Zen or meditation. And by using that instrument in the production, I'm also able to further add to that overall expression of serenity. So we've talked about, there's quite a few methods of coding emotional meaning through music, and they all work at the same time. There's not just one that's completely controlling everything. But with that, let's do one more song, and I'll show you the sad song. You did have to get sad. Understanding of the dimensional model of motion. One more time. So we see here that we have different emotional categories plotted on this two-dimensional emotional space. And as I had mentioned, these are built up of valence on the x-axis and arousal on the y-axis. And so again, anger is a low valence, high arousal emotion, whereas serenity on the opposite end is a high valence, low arousal emotion. So what I've done is actually I've created a visualization for this using this space in a useful way. So for example, when we're feeling happy or the user is feeling happy, their emotions are represented by this ball here, and they're in this quadrant, in this general space. When we're, as it changes colors, pretty cool. and when we're angry or afraid, our emotions are in this quadrant, and like I had said, it's low valence, high arousal. Moving on to sadness, our emotions are generally in this quadrant, low valence, low arousal. And over here, for serenity, high valence, low arousal. So there's different combinations that create these different emotional representations on this two-dimensional space. So I can also control this with my face, and we'll see more of that later. But let me change that song up. Yeah, so it's actually... we'll do more of that later. So the way I did this is another example of just utilizing machine learning in this project. In the first layer, it was a classification task where I had the computer learn how to classify from 1 to 5 emotions. But in this model, I correlated different facial expressions to different pairs of numbers that represented their approximate valence and arousal values. And after the computer had enough data, I was able to train it and be able to make new assumptions on unlabeled data like this. I'm giving this in real time. It doesn't have a pre-label to it, but it could learn. It had learned what to associate that facial expression with. So as I input my face, you see here, it's sending data, and I'm just interpreting that and visualizing it using Max. So that's how that's all working. So how can we use this musically? So we can actually easily ascribe different musical structures and their gradations to the different values of valence and arousal. So for example, we could assign mode to the valence dimension. So over here, we have, and this is low valence, so we could assign modes such as like Locrian or Phrygian or just dark sounding modes, dark minor bass modes with a lowered third. And as we continue over this direction, we're going to get into more major sounding modes, such as maybe Mixolydian, major Ionian, Lydian, perhaps Lydian augmented as we head this direction. So, but most of the time in this project, I'm just using a dichotomy of either major or minor, depending on the side of the graph that it's on. But that's how we can assign this valence value to musical meaning. And secondly, we could assign tempo to the arousal dimension. So this is music will have a lower tempo that has a low arousal, and as we rise up, it's going to have a higher tempo. So it's actually, let's hear this in action. I'll play a short song I composed called Serenade. It's just a short repeating loop, but we'll listen to it a few times so we can get it in our ears, then I'll be able to modulate it with this graph here. Changing the motion location of the space. So I can actually control this with the mouse as you saw. Let's do that with that. Let's control it that way first. a system to change several musical structures all at the same time to change the overall emotional expression. I think it creates a very dynamic music editing and music making tool where you could transform so many features at one time to change the whole overall emotional expression. As you're probably expecting, I could do this with my face as well, so I'll show you a little demonstration of that. I'm feeling happy right now, so I'll give it a smile.
Thank you.
saw how the song transformed based on the location of the ball in that emotional space. Like I said, this song is the first in the group of songs I hope to write that are just a little more fully integrated into this mood modulator system. But I have quite a few ideas on applications for this. One is in virtual reality or augmented reality environments, this could be used to give users unprecedented influence on the music that accompanies the games or the videos that they're watching by allowing them to have some way to control the music that's being played or have a little bit of influence on it. I think that would provide a really unique user experience that hasn't really been done before by giving the user the ability to control the music for the game they're playing or the video they're watching. So lastly, we are in layer 3. It's called Mood Generator. And so Mood Generator builds off the previous layers in a few ways. The first layer, which is Emotion Jukebox, was mostly concerned with just identification of emotion and playing back a song that I had composed. As we just saw, Mood Modulator was concerned with transforming an existing piece of music by using your facial expressions. Mood Generator differs in that there's no musical content there already. There's no melody, there's no accompanying parts. The musical material is generated from the computer based on the input of facial expression. So what you're going to hear is a brand new original melody that has never been heard before. I'm going to default it to a happy sound first. Explain. So this is the very beginning stages of Mood Generator. Like I said, the main task was to be able to generate musical material in real time. And from this, I could actually modify that same song by using the same methodology that I had used in layer 2. So let's pull up another melody. This is also an original melody that the computer came up with. Found that listening to music that's congruent to your negative emotions actually helps you process these emotions more quickly than simply listening to a happy song when you're feeling angry or a calm song when you're feeling sad. By listening to music that matches your emotion, it helps you process them. But what could be created is a progressive playlist that begins, if you're feeling sad, begins happy, moves forward to less happy, and progressively, the last song will put you in that serene emotional space. Or similarly, for angry, it can progressively move you from giving an angry song when you're angry, but gradually moving to a happy song. I think this could, it hasn't been tested yet, but I think this could actually be useful for people in the context of music therapy. Yes. Secondly, mood modulator, which I think we all understand quite well, one interesting application could be utilizing it in a performer basis. So imagine like a DJ or some other mixed media performer can have control their whole set by using their facial expressions. They could transform a song that's going on from happy to sad or angry to calm by just using the facial expressions or by this graph system that I created. I think that offer both the performer a really unique performance experience as well as give the listener a really unique listening experience in live performance situations. And lastly, mood generator, which we just saw a second ago, though it's in its initial stages, and this last application combines all these ideas here, but I haven't studied music therapy formally, but one concept I've come across is the idea of active music therapy, and that's where the patient, rather than being playing music or listening to music, is actually involved in the music-making process themselves, either by singing or playing or writing music. And I feel like the system in general is useful in that context because it would allow the user, that may not be physically capable or have the cognitive ability to be able to create or play music, to allow them to choose the music they want to listen to, to be able to control the music they're listening to in a really fun and interactive way, and lastly, be able to create music for themselves by using their just innate emotional expression. I think this would bring a lot of accessibility to the people in those spaces. Lastly, before I do the short Q&A, let's put this back here. I just want to thank everyone for being here again. I want to thank God for making music. I want to thank my wife, Juliet, for supporting me through this. I want to thank my parents and family, and my advisors, Dr. Mark Volker, Master Ellen Goble, and Dr. Eric Tart. I thank you guys for your encouragement and your input throughout this whole process. So, thank you. So, I guess we could open up to a Q&A. Guys, have any questions or anything? Yes.
So, can you take a song that already exists that I listen to on the radio or whatever and change the mood of it with this program?
I would have to, at this point, I would have to recreate it first.
Okay.
And then implement it into the system. Okay. But that'd be really awesome.
Yeah,
that'd be cool. Yeah, great question.
How did you choose, I guess, mode and tempo to be the X and Y axes in terms of the valence? Like, how did you choose them, and then also how did you ascribe, probably research, I imagine.
Yeah.
as well as, like, weightedness of arousal or valence. Like, how did you determine what was going to be, what was going to take place?
So, for tempo, I put the bottom, at the bottom of arousal, I put the lowest tempo that's possible, about 48 beats per minute, and then the highest is about 180. So, that was the whole scale that can be chosen for tempo, and that was chosen just for general speeds that music we hear from day to day, and nothing's usually much slower than that, and a lot of things aren't much faster than that. So that was the dimensions that I placed. And all the reason I assigned tempo to arousal is it's actually been found in research from what I've been reading, that that's the dimensions that's most easily kind of given that correlation to that musical structure. And for mode, it's been found similarly as well. It's a little more, it's not as defined as I presented it in the research. It was a little more question marks to it, but it was just found that having a graph up for everyone again, more minor sounding modes, the darker modes that have, so like low Phrygian or Phrygian that have a lot of flatted intervals compared to the major scale, They correlated with lower valence, lower valence values. And obviously, major was the baseline, was the default, and then I was able to subtract different intervals from the different modes by translating the valence value to the programming module that was built. Does that make sense? Cool. Great. Yes?
So I'm assuming you composed all the different music we heard for the different expressions
yes,
and features. So how did you go about deciding what instruments you wanted to use for those different moves?
Great question. So some of it was genre specific. And I did mention this earlier, but for anger, a lot of people just naturally associate metal music with anger. And whether that's true or not, it's that association is there. And so, for example, I just chose, you know, instruments commonly used in that genre, so electric guitars, heavy drums. And for example, on Happiness, I mentioned the instrument choices. I was trying to reference September by Earth, Wind, and Fire. And for Sadness, I was referencing perhaps like a romantic cello concerto, or a similar sound to that. And just by using some of the built-in correlations that some of these genres have, that's how I chose the instrumentation and the overall production choices. Great. Yes?
So like a composer could use this in their own way. It could be developed where they are creating their music and having it tweaked by the system.
Exactly, yeah. It could be, I could see it as a really dynamic like music editing tool.
Yeah.
And it could be really just, I mean, most composers, they know how to do this themselves, but it'd be fun to just make a really large kind of like meta controller to control all these features at once. I think it'd be a really interesting use of the technology. It does, yes.
So my immediate thought was, how can you use this in a platform in which people are taking all the selfies you mentioned?
Yeah.
And so something like Snapchat, where if you had, you know, I just wonder if you'd considered applications in the social media realm where if somebody takes a selfie and sends it, all of a sudden their music could play.
Yeah, that's actually one of my next goals. I'm trying to learn like software development myself right now in a more formal context. So for like iOS development, it'd be awesome to make just an app that does exactly that. So that's in the works, actually.
Yeah, that's
yeah. Cool. Thank you. Great. Hey, John. Yeah.
Hey, Nate. I know it's Nathan, not Nate, but he can attest I'm not a gifted student, but I work in healthcare, but I can see where this actually music therapy is increasingly like becoming part of like treatment for patients.
Mm-hmm.
So I can absolutely see where this could take on music therapy.
Yeah, that'd be great.
I can connect. Yeah.
Oh, I would love to. That'd be
yeah,
great.
No, it's absolutely like
yeah.
My friend is. It's tremendous. It's excellent.
Cool. Great. Thank you.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That was amazing.
Cool.
They should give you your doctorate.
But also have applications for learning. I mean, my graduate work in Philadelphia, unfortunately, there was a station that did classical music 24 hours a day with no interruption. So when I went to study, I turned that on, and that's
mm-hmm.
the way I learned.
Yeah, yeah.
For those 5 years. So.
Gotcha. Oh yeah, I can totally see that. Being able to choose.
Yeah.
Exactly. Yeah. Very cool. Oh, over here, David.
I want to get together and talk through all these possible applications with you because they're just like right here. One immediate thing is that, you know, my kids have sleep issues. It's very difficult to find the right music to help them, but the right music really does help them fall asleep.
Mm-hmm.
And so what you were talking about with sort of those progressive playlists,
mm-hmm.
bringing them down to
mm-hmm.
this serene state, I think would be awesome.
Yeah.
I think
yeah.
it could do wonders in that way.
Cool.
I mean, that's just like the tip of the iceberg with that stuff.
Can we
also
get the slides?
What was that?
Can we get the slides?
The slides?
Yeah.
I'm sorry.
Oh, no, like the presentation. Like.
Oh, yeah, sure.
I think
yeah.
he wants
yeah.
you to send them the present.
Oh, sure. Cool.
Yeah,
yeah.
Because I got some knowledge.
Yeah, definitely. I'll be able to send you a video.
Okay.
Yeah.
Cool.
Great. Yes.
I think in that vein, I mentioned to you, you know, about like helping kids on the spectrum with this and communication and understanding emotions and everything. Using those progressive playlists, you know, when kids get really upset and they don't, you know, people with autism or Asperger's or just on the spectrum have a lot of trouble coping with those feelings.
Mm-hmm.
And so they often take in everything differently, and utilizing those kind of progressive playlists to help like calm them down and like hone their senses back in instead of just being overwhelmed by everything. That would be something that could also be relatively useful.
Very cool, yeah, great idea.
Piggybacking on that, I actually have the same thought. With children with autism spectrum disorders, I used to teach children with autism spectrum disorders, and I think one of the hallmark challenges was emoting, attenuating visually, with faces in particular. So even outside of the context of de-escalating, you know, emotional irregularities, just the ability to understand the effect of how a particular facial reaction has, not just with human beings, but how potentially, you know, if they're a la selfie interacting with what you're making, that can also show them, hey, when you make this face or when you're having this reaction, this may become the effect in teaching empathy.
Yeah, that'd be excellent. That's a good idea.
One more question.
Sure.
So the way you were doing it, you were basically taking a picture and it was jumping to that emotion.
Yes.
Can you do it, as opposed to having pictures, could you do videos to where it changes it in real time?
Yeah, I can. Let me demonstrate that, actually. I can do that with, I'll show that with this one. See if my...
You look great, so...
and just create different sounds while I'm playing it. If I could also use my face to control yet another parameter at the same time, I mean, that would save me a lot of time. I go back in and do that stuff by hand so often.
Yeah.
Being able to do it all live would be amazing.
Yeah, that was one of the main, as I mentioned again, just adding an extended controller that is really a very natural way of using your body to control musical expression. Great. Well, let's end it there.
Yeah.
Thank you.